Hello everyone, this is the Crash Course by me, Anuj Jindal, and today we are going to discuss something very, very important which has been picked up from RBI website very recently by me. The topic is external commercial borrowings and FPI norms which have been revised recently by RBI and they have been presented in RBI website. So without wasting any time, let's start with the Crash Course on ECB norms. What exactly are external commercial borrowings? These are the borrowings or loans which are taken by eligible resident entities, that means companies, from recognized non-resident entities, that is companies which are or institutions which are non-resident in India. They have to conform to various parameters, various provisions, various requirements like minimum maturity for which they can take those loans, permitted and non-permitted end uses, how can you use those loans, and what can be the maximum cost at which you can borrow those loans. There are three tracks for raising loans as external commercial borrowings: track 1, track 2 and track 3, and these are very, very important. I am expecting a question from this area in the upcoming examination. Track 1 is when you are borrowing for a medium term and it is a foreign currency denominated external commercial borrowing, and the minimum average maturity is 3 to 5 years. Now, it has been broken down here further. 3 years the maturity for an ECB which is denominated in foreign currency, for which in which you are borrowing up to $50 million, and the maturity, minimum maturity, is 5 years if you are borrowing more than $50 million. 5 years for eligible borrowers under, that is not important, and 5 years for foreign currency convertible bonds. If you are borrowing through FCCBs or FCEBs, then the minimum maturity is 5 years. Track 2 is for long-term borrowing in the form of foreign currency only, and the minimum average maturity is 10 years in case of track 2. And in case of track 3, the difference is that the borrowing is denominated in Indian rupee and not in foreign currency. Let's say an Indian bank or let's say any entity, any company wants to borrow from USA, then if you are borrowing under track 3, then you are borrowing in terms of rupees. But if you are borrowing in track 1, then you are borrowing in terms of US dollars. The minimum average maturity is 3 to 5 years and the provisions are the same. 3 years if your borrowing is up to $50 million, and 5 years minimum maturity if you are borrowing more than $50 million. What are the ways in which you can borrow under external commercial borrowings? So these are the 7 ways in which you can borrow. You can borrow it as a bank loan. You can take a bank loan from any foreign bank. You can borrow it as a securitized instrument. Securitized instrument means fixed rate bonds and flexible rate bonds, non-convertible, optionally convertible or partially convertible shares or debentures. You can take loan as a buyer's credit or as a supplier's credit. Now, buyer's credit is a loan facility extended to an importer by a bank or financial institution. Let's say I am an importer who is importing certain goods or services from another country, and in that import, whatever I'm importing, I am getting some goods and I am paying some money, whether it is rupees or dollars. Now, in order to get that goods, I might need certain loan by a bank, and when a bank or a financial institution is financing me for importing those goods, then I am getting money in the form of buyer's credit. Now, I can also borrow that loan as an external commercial borrowing. If I am borrowing that money from an outside agency, from an institution which is not in India. A supplier's credit is very similar, wherein an exporter is extending the credit. So this is the importer and this is the exporter. If the exporter is financing the importer, then it will be called as a supplier's credit because the supplier is providing credit. And a buyer's credit when a foreign bank is providing finance to this importer, then it's called a buyer's credit. It can be borrowed as a foreign currency convertible bond, a financial lease. A financial lease is when you borrow from a foreign institution which buys a property. Let's say this is a foreign bank. It buys a property in India and it provides you lease in order to rent that property, in order to use that property. So the property belongs to the foreign bank or the foreign investor or the foreign creditor, but you can use it as a on lease, and then you can borrow as on through foreign currency exchangeable bonds also. So these are the seven ways through which you can borrow from recognized non-resident entities. What are the new norms for FPI? Now, FPI and ECB new norms are connected, and we'll be connecting them in the future slides. So let's have a look at the new norms for FPI. Number one, the residual maturity has reduced. What is residual maturity? The maturity that remains. It means that, for example, there is a bond, the maturity period for which is 10 years, let's say. So after 10 years, it is going to get redeemed. It was issued, let's say, 4 years back from today. And today you decide to buy that particular bond. So the residual or the remaining maturity is 6 years, because 4 years have already passed. So this is residual maturity. It has been reduced. We'll be talking about this. The auction mechanism has been withdrawn, and the cap on aggregate or total FPI investments in a single security, the cap or the ceiling has been revised. We'll be talking about that as well. What is the purpose of all these changes, all these new norms that have been pushed forward by RBI? The purpose is to boost foreign fund flows into Indian debt market. Why does the RBI or the government want to do this? The purpose is to cool off borrowing costs, because borrowing costs will reduce when there is more demand for Indian debt in the foreign market, or when the foreign fund is flowing into India in order to invest in Indian debt, and in order to reduce the yields on government securities and also on other types of securities. Now, what are these changes? The central bank has withdrawn the minimum residual maturity required by FPIs to invest in central government securities and state development loans. So the minimum residual maturity has been withdrawn, subject to a condition that investment in securities with residual maturity below 1 year should not exceed 20% of total investment by FPI in that category. So let's say FPIs, these are FPIs, all the FPIs, and these are government securities where FPIs has invested. Now let's say all the FPIs together have invested a total of rupees 100 in the government securities of India. Now it says that when or where the government security has a maturity period of less than 1 year, a part of these government securities worth rupees 100 will have maturity period of less than 1 year. Let's say this is 40 rupees. Government securities worth 40 rupees have a maturity period of less than 1 year. Residual maturity, not the overall maturity. If the residual maturity is less than 1 year, then it should not, the investment of FPIs should not exceed 20% of total investment of that FPI in that category. So it should not exceed rupees 20. So out of this 40 rupees, only FPI investment can be only up to rupees 20 in the government securities where residual maturity is below 1 year. So far, FPIs were required to invest in government securities with minimum residual maturity of 3 years. So now they have been allowed to invest in government securities where minimum residual maturity can be below 1 year also. Considering or keeping in mind that the overall investment of all FPIs in this category cannot be more than 20% of total investment of FPIs in that category of government securities. Number two, for corporate bonds, FPIs are permitted to invest in papers with minimum residual maturity of above 1 year. The step is likely to bring in considerable foreign fund flows, arguably an attractive segment for foreign investors. So for corporate bonds, if an FPI is investing in a corporate bond in India, they can invest in these papers with minimum residual maturity of above 1 year. So it has been changed now. Minimum residual maturity is above 1 year. So if it is below 1 year, you cannot invest in corporate bonds. The central bank has also revised the cap on aggregate, again, aggregate FPI investments in any central government security to 30% of the outstanding stock of that security. So there are a lot of government securities. It is not that government securities are only of one kind. There can be hundreds of types of government securities. In each type, this is one type, in each type of government security, the aggregate FPI investment cannot be more than 30% of outstanding stock of that security. Let's say government security type 1 is into the market up to rupees 100. Rupees 100 is the total investment, total issue that the government has made of this type of government security. Then the investment by FPIs cannot exceed 30% or rupees 30 of this type of government security. It has been increased from 20%. The central bank has also harmonized the all-in cost for external commercial borrowings over the benchmark rate. The cost ceiling has been increased and it has been made uniform. So now the ceiling is 450 basis points over the benchmark rate. It was 300 to 500 basis points depending upon the risk of that external commercial borrowing that is being made. And it has now been uniform to 450 basis points or 4.5% over the benchmark rate. What is the benchmark rate? 6 month US dollars LIBOR. That is the benchmark rate. This is also important. You should remember this. The next one is, it has been decided to permit housing finance companies and port trust to avail of ECBs under all tracks. So now housing finance companies, what are housing finance companies? This is a housing finance company. This housing finance company is going to provide finance to a real estate developer. A housing finance company is going to provide finance to a real estate developer who is going to construct a building. And this building is going to be sold off to domestic or international buyers. Buyer can be of any kind, given that he is complying with the rules of India. So housing finance company is providing finance to a real estate developer who is the one who is creating this building that is being sold off to people. So now it has been permitted that housing finance companies can raise money through ECBs. Similarly for port trusts. Also, companies engaged in the business of maintenance, repair and overhaul of freight forwarding to raise ECBs denominated in INR only, that is track 3. Currently a positive end use list. This is very, very interesting. Now presently there is a positive list for track 1, that is who all can raise money through track 1, and a negative list for track 2 and 3. Now it has been changed to a negative list for all 3 tracks. All 3 tracks. What a negative list and positive list means is that in a negative list you have specified who all are the people who cannot take money. So a negative list is, as the name itself says, who are the people who cannot issue bonds or who cannot borrow through the external commercial borrowing route. So certain list is created and certain types are provided, types are specified or classified, who cannot issue bonds or who cannot borrow through ECB route, who cannot issue bonds in order to borrow through ECB route. Whereas a positive list is wherein you specify a certain number of classifications, a certain number of class of people or class of entities which can borrow through ECB route. This is a little difficult to regulate or to manage. This is easier to manage, and this allows more classes of entities to borrow through ECB route. It has now been decided to have only negative list for all tracks. The negative list for all tracks would include the following. Number one, investment in real estate. So you cannot borrow if you want to invest in real estate directly or purchase. Housing finance companies are different. These are financing companies. If you are a real estate developer and you want to borrow in order to develop a real estate enterprise, or purchase of land. You cannot borrow to purchase land except when using it for affordable housing. If you're using it for affordable housing, then you can do it. Investment in capital market. You cannot borrow to invest in capital market. You cannot say I will borrow through ECB route and whatever money I get, I will invest it in capital market. Similarly, equity investment. You cannot borrow in order to invest it in the equity market, whether capital market includes both equity as well as bonds. What are the rules, new rules for investments by foreign portfolio investors? Certain rules we went through, certain norms. The limit for FPI investment in central government securities would be increased to 5.5% and then 6%, 0.5% each year. Now, the limit that we talked about in the previous slide was the aggregate FPI limits. This is the FPI limit for every FPI investor. The limit for FPI investment in state development loans would remain unchanged at 2% of outstanding stock of securities. This is something very important. You should remember this. The overall limit for FPI investment in corporate bonds will be fixed at 9% of outstanding stock of corporate bonds. Let's have a look at a question. Which of the following correctly defines external commercial borrowings? External commercial borrowings are commercial loans raised by eligible resident entities. This is correct. Raised by eligible non-resident entities. No, only the resident entities in India are going to raise money. Loans raised by banks. Are banks the only entities? No, corporations or enterprises or companies can also raise money through external commercial borrowing route. Raised by financial institutions, a little confusing, but let's keep it aside and let's then finalize it later. So second and third are out. Eligible resident entities from recognized non-resident entities. Nothing wrong about it. From recognized non-resident institutions. It is technically to use entities because institutions excludes certain classes of entities, certain classes of enterprises. Therefore, this is a more clear and an answer which is nearer to what we want to define. Consider the following statements about ECBs and identify the incorrect one. Track 1, track 2, track 3. Medium term, long term, Indian rupee denominated. There is nothing called as track 4. If you have gone through this, only then can you understand this and answer this question. Otherwise, you might get confused because this refers to short term foreign currency denominated ECBs. ECBs cannot be short term in nature. They can only be medium term, long term and Indian rupee denominated. Permitted resident entities can now borrow from recognized non-resident entities in the following forms except. You can borrow as a loan including bank loans. You can borrow through securitized instruments. You can borrow through buyer's credit. Can you borrow through mortgage loans? What are mortgage loans? Can you borrow from an external entity by putting collateral as your land or as your house or as your property? No, you cannot do that. You can do that only in the case of affordable housing that I specified, that I mentioned in the previous slide, but in any other case you cannot borrow it in this manner. Therefore, this is the most incorrect answer. Let's have a look at another question. The RBI has revised its rules for investments by foreign portfolio investors in Indian bonds. Which of the following is not one of the revisions? Reduction of residual maturity. Yes, that has been done. Withdrawal of auction mechanism. Auction mechanism now has been withdrawn. Yes. The cap of aggregate FPI investments in a single security, that has also been revised. Central bank has mandated a uniform ceiling of 300 basis points. Now, there is a uniform ceiling, but the uniform ceiling is 450 basis points over the benchmark rate. So this is an incorrect answer. If you like my lecture, please subscribe to my channel so that I can be motivated to create more such beautiful videos. You can also provide feedback in the comment section below so that I can make improvements on these videos. You can also join my Facebook and Telegram groups and channels, which are called as Success RBI 2018. I come out with daily quizzes as well as PDFs for both phase 1 and phase 2, and you can take advantage of those. I would recommend that you join my YouTube community, wherein I am coming out with regular tests, quizzes or MCQs on a regular or daily basis. I am also coming out with notifications on all the videos that are posted by me over there. You can also join or download the app that I have, which is called as Infinity. It is available on Android Google Play Store. There, all the past PDFs as well as quizzes are available, and you can download as well as take those quizzes.